The following podcast has some fruity language. Sorry, my bad. So take care of who's listening around you. Kia ora koutou katoa. Welcome to It's Personal with me, Anika Moa. This is a podcast where I talk to some wonderful humans, bringing you frank and intimate insights into subjects that are personal to me and my guests.
I auditioned for drama school and failed miserably.
How?
I went in there, I think I was just so kind of like ill-prepared. I don't know, I thought I could just waltz in there, like I'd learn my monologue and be the best.
Yeah.
And I argued with the person doing the audition about the acoustics of this of the place I was at. Like, why did I do that?
Now, I love a good laugh, and not many people are funnier than my guest this week. He's a podcaster, performer, and social media genius. He is Tom Sainsbury. God, he's good. Thomas Sainsbury, eh?
Anika Moa.
Yeah.
As I live and breathe.
As I live and breathe.
Cheers. Beautiful.
Cheers.
Glasses you've got here. Mm. This is your home, I presume?
Yeah. This is where I cohabitat with my four angel kids.
Yeah.
At RNZ in one of their dark spaces. I was just thinking to do this podcast. I think I want to start from the start.
Mm-hmm.
I think I want to start with understanding you grew up in Matamata.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what was that like?
Good. What was my, growing up in Matamata was, people assume it was like a lot tougher than it was. The thing is that there was a there's a thriving amateur dramatic society in Matamata.
Yeah.
So pretty early on, I kind of discovered this as an avenue and found my people.
Yeah.
And so fell in love with the amateur dramatics and operatic society, but unfortunately I can't sing. So I was more kind of in the, you know, I was the chorus member.
Do you really think that you can't sing? Because I say I can't act.
Mm. And I have, and I not only have I, do I know you can act, I've acted in a scene with you.
Have we?
Yes.
What did we do?
Bird Woman. Wellington Paranormal.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, you had so much to worry about. Of course, you, you were like, what?
But also really sick during COVID
yes,
as well.
You were.
And we still went to work because I had to. I couldn't, because all you guys would have lost a day. It would have been Blame It on Anika Week.
Yeah.
That's right. I was the bird woman and you were one of the policemen.
That's right.
We have worked together.
And you were fantastic. But also like.
You never said that on the day, but that's
I'm
cool.
I'm sure. I just felt so sorry for it because you had harnesses, right?
Everything. And a big fat bird suit.
With face and stuff too, and wings.
Yeah, and they rubbed yellow in my teeth so it looked like I was eating bugs and stuff. And I looked like probably if I was 60 living in the bush.
I thought it took years off. I thought it took 10 years off you.
Anyway,
so Matamata, yes, found that community pretty early on.
Yeah.
There was definitely a, so what was it like? It was, I'm an introvert, so I loved having like the farm to myself, walking around and stuff.
You grew up on a farm, what, dairy or what is
dairy,
it?
Dairy, yeah, dairy.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So your dad?
So my dad would get up at 4:30 a.m. every day.
Would you help him?
I helped him. I iodized the teats. Which is a whole thing. So you don't get so that the cows don't get mastitis. Someone has to come along after they've been milked.
Yeah.
And you have to spray them with iodine.
So you were doing farm life.
Yeah, I was doing
with your dad.
Yeah. I didn't take to it naturally. And the thing that's probably
of course
caused the
not.
Most the thing that probably caused the most trauma was backing the trailers.
Oh, okay.
And my dad's kind of a you're sticking at this until you've cracked it.
Yeah.
So there was lots of jackknifing trailers, lifting like when you jackknife it so badly it lifts off the hook and kind of goes flying somewhere. Yeah.
And so was he quite because do you have siblings?
I've got an older brother and an older sister.
Okay, and was he quite hard on you being the youngest and wanting you to learn the farm life and maybe pass it on to you?
My siblings would probably say that I was the least, that he was least hard on. I was the most spoiled.
Is it because he knew you were gay?
I was part of the rainbow community.
Yeah.
I think he would have been, I think it was just like the natural Yeah, probably.
Does a parent know, Zay? A parent knows.
Yeah, well, I think a mother always knows. Yeah. I don't know if a dad always knows.
I think a dad knows, but they like to bury their head in the sand. That's
your
conclusion. Because my mum, when I told her I was gay, well, that I was seeing a woman actually, not gay, she was just like, yeah, okay, well, anyway, I've got to get your brother to school, and it's probably just a phrase. I'm like, isn't it phase, Mum? She's like, yeah, phrase. Anyway, your brother's been so naughty, he's on his PS3 or whatever it was back then, told my dad, and he was part of the Destiny Church, and he said, oh, I love you, but I hate the sin. And
really?
I was like, so? I was like, I didn't care what he thought, basically.
But you were, how old were you?
21. Yeah. When I came out, I suppose, to my family.
Yeah.
I
was much later, I was in my late 20s.
How old?
I kind of maybe have buried it all, maybe 27, 28.
Well, that's late, but you know, everyone has their own time, right?
Everyone has their own time, and also, like, I was just living, like, having boyfriends and stuff, and
secretly.
Years and years and years. And girls, girlfriends and boyfriends.
Oh, I know. I'm good friends with one of your exes. Mm. So you're this young... Did you know that you were gay when growing up in Matamata? Did you have a little feeling?
I had... It's such an interesting thing, isn't it? Because you do know...
It's so cliche. Small town, dairy farmer, son.
But you just kind of like... convince yourself you're not, or you convince yourself not even to address it all. But in saying that, like, there was a couple of boys that was just so flamboyantly gay, and everyone kind of knew it was an unspoken secret at the thing. But then there was the ones more on the margin that could kind of act otherwise, and I was kind of more in that. But you know, everyone knew. God, if only I was mature enough to kind of have been able to handle it.
What? So you joined the Theatric Society, and that's what got you into acting and your love for the stage.
I think it was... Okay, there's multiple things. I think I idolised my sister as a child, and she would do drama. So I don't know whether, like, it would be... I just was trying to emulate her. But then I just remember seeing shows when I was little and just being obsessed with them and excited by it all. So I think it was kind of always there too.
Mm.
Yeah, I think it's inherently part of who I am.
Yeah, so, but what if your sister hadn't have done drama? Would you have found that your way to it?
Eventually, I reckon.
Yeah, okay.
But maybe it'd taken a bit longer.
Yeah, yeah. When did you move to, well, when did you break free from small town Matamata? I've actually done gigs there and they're really good crowds.
Yeah.
Like, they love you there. They're like, we love you.
Because that, yes, we won't talk, like, I just love that. That was when you were doing Kiri, you were doing that. Yeah, I just love that.
You know,
I love that.
You remember
that.
The two,
yes, of course.
What was it called? Yeah. The double name tour or something, and I did Kiri Kiri and Matamata, and I can't remember the rest.
Yeah, I love that.
How brilliant.
I know, such a brilliant idea.
Thank you.
I've done a few gigs in Matamata, and
they love you.
They love me, but... I guess they are more tentative. It just takes them a little longer to get them laughing.
Why? Because I had them laughing within 30 seconds.
I know, but that's Anika Moa. I was 18 when I was 18, or just or 17, 18, and moved up here to do. I auditioned for drama school and failed miserably.
How?
I went in there, I think I was just so kind of like ill prepared. I don't know, I thought I could just waltz in there, like I'd learn my monologue and be the best.
Yeah.
And I argued with the person doing the audition about the acoustics of this of the place I was at. Like, why did I do that? And then part of it was doing an improv with the other people auditioning, and I came with a hot tub. I came in, like, you had to kind of work out who the murderer was. And for some reason I just came in and just said I was the murderer straight off. Anyway, my soul still cringes about
this
audition. Yeah.
Are you being serious? Like, is it really... I mean, was
hugely embarrassed by it.
Who was the person who was auditioning you? Like, do they have you talked to them yet?
He, unfortunately, died.
Oh, okay.
Do you know the Unitech guy? Can you remember him? What was his name?
I don't
anyway,
know.
Anyway, so the secret...
I've never been to drama
the
school.
The secret's gone. I'm the only one that was there now.
But you've just told me in my podcast.
Yeah. for eternity.
So you flunked your audition for drama school. Was that a good thing or a bad thing? I mean, I'm seeing it as a good thing because with your success that you've had so far.
I think what it probably was. So I came up to Auckland and did English literature at university and really got into the theatre scene heavily at the university and started doing my own kind of shows.
Yeah.
Just at like pubs and bars and galleries and stuff around Auckland.
You worked the traps.
Yeah, I worked the traps. And I would hang out with all these actors. Lots of them still doing acting now, but they were all very kind of serious about it, and they held up Robert De Niro as their kind of hero and stuff like that. And it wasn't until, and I thought, maybe this isn't for me, this acting style. And it wasn't until I started hanging out with your Morgana O'Reillys and your Madeline Sarmies and stuff like that. I'm like, this is my style.
Yeah, good, yeah. That comedy, that loose, the whole, what's it called? The Whose Line Is It Anyway? Improv?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, so 2023, you've started the year with a podcast.
Correct.
Small Town Scandal.
Yes.
And you finished it with a big, huge movie release. And it's screened at Screamfest. What's Screamfest in the US?
Screamfest is a horror-specific genre festival that they have in LA every year. And it's, you go there and it's just like 80% how you imagine it.
Yeah.
Just guys with patchy facial hair and drinking lots of soda, going in and really appreciating horror. And then occasional girlfriend.
Yeah.
And then...
Well, just so mostly guys.
Yeah.
It's like going to a barbecue meat burning session or something like that.
Yeah, but they're such a great audience. They're so good.
Okay. And so what's your podcast about, Small Town Scandal?
So the second season's come out over Christmas.
Yeah.
And it is a... I've spent a lot of time listening to true crime podcasts. So, you know, like S-Town, Serial, those kind of ones.
Yeah.
And the tropes are just so, are so
teacher's bordering pet. On
teacher's pet.
Black hands. So, I know, I love them.
And so I just kind of like, I was so aware of the tropes. I was like, this would be great for a parody. So I've done it's called Small Town Scandal, and I play all the characters in the town, and it's solving the mystery of who killed the main characters. His uncle's the richest man in town, and his body's found kind of torn up by automated lawnmowers, but he's kind of, it's a bit suspicious, so he's solving that. And so he goes around, you know, interviewing everyone. Everyone's,
I love it.
So much of it's Mata Mata kind of inspired, but it's set in the Wairarapa.
Aye.
Yeah.
Do you write it all yourself?
That's all written by myself.
Do that. That's a lot of script. That's a lot of time.
It is a lot of time. I think what's so amazing about it is, like, dialogue is my favourite part of it, and I think that's all it is.
Is that your path, you know, because I know that you've done Loop Track. How did that begin? Because it takes years to make movies, eh?
It does.
Okay.
And I kind of want to speed that process up next time. Like, I'm talking 6 years for this one. So,
I wouldn't have the patience for that.
Well, it kind of, like, just life just can kind of happens and you kind of pick it up again. But yeah. me and these three guys, there's a competition called the 48-hour film competition.
Yeah.
And we won it in 2016 and then again in 2018. So we had this kind of prize money that we could do something with, and it would have been a really good short film, but we were like, let's make a feature film. And so we started writing it back then, and then just slowly and surely, once you get other people involved and suddenly you've got deadlines, suddenly a film's getting made. And then we finished it in 2022, but we decided to kind of hold it and release it as part of the New Zealand Film Festival.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, and then from there it kind of had general release and went around the world.
And why did, because it's about, it's you're playing a character who goes to the forest to find himself or to heal or to lost in his thoughts?
It's more healing himself, I'd say. Like he's running away from his life. And so he's kind of on the verge of a nervous breakdown. Everything's kind of crashing down around him. And he's kind of to get away from it all. But, you know, is he there to self-harm? Or it's kind of like, you know, it's all a mystery. And the problem is he wants to be alone. But when you do tramp, you naturally gravitate. Other trampers kind of gravitate towards you. So he has this kind of worst nightmare where these very talkative trampers attach themselves to him.
Okay. And it's a horror, so there's things that go wrong and bad and death and blood and gory.
Yeah, you got it. I meant to talk it as a podcast. Yes, that's what happens.
When I first heard about the movie and saw the preview, I thought that maybe this is what you'd written. He goes into the forest and then heaps of horror happens, but it turns out at the end of the movie he'd taken a bad trip, like an acid trip or mushrooms, and it was all in his imagination.
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's a really good... That is... I haven't heard that take. I love it. And do you know what? It can fit.
Ooh.
That take and fit. I think it's like I purposely try to make it like people can interpret it how they want.
Okay.
Yeah.
One thing that I love about you is that you're constantly releasing things. You're constantly on Facebook, on Instagram. It's like you work around the clock. But how do you get hold of your ideas? Because I've got 10 million ideas, but I'm just like, oh, sure. And they all just float away.
I have become better at recording it. Like when there's really good ideas, like I just you'd be like, oh, what was that one? Oh, it's gone. So I do scribble them down now, but sometimes you read it going, rabbit and dog. what the hell is rabbit and dog? And then that's gone. That idea's gone. I find in this, what I kind of do is that inspiration kind of happens all the time. And when you do switch off and you go on a holiday or something, that's when the most inspiration comes.
Okay.
So, like, when you do go travel or something, then you're suddenly hyper-aware of human behaviour and then you just kind of take it all on board. So I think I definitely don't work around the clock, and there's definitely, like, many hours essentially wasted or lying in the bed staring at the ceiling.
Yeah.
But it is a job that you can do all the time.
Yeah, it is. But... what I'm trying to get at is you're really, really clever. Do you realise how clever you are? Because not everyone can do what you do. In fact, I don't think anyone in New Zealand does what you do.
Thank you, Anika. That's really lovely.
It's the truth. That's how I see it.
Thank you. I think that... I think there's multiple things kind of going on. I think I come from a family of observers. Like, I definitely remember some things that... you know, we'd be driving in the car as a family and they'd be kind of commenting on some person's choice of cardigan or something, and that would be a discussion point. And then,
oh,
like,
my God, judging.
I know. Yes, it is really judgy, and there's a fine line between, like, essentially when I make characters, like, I am judging them and I'm being cruel and teasing them, but at the same time, like, I've got so much love for them as well.
Yeah.
And then I think it's just fine-tuning that talent or what's in the family. Yeah, and I've just spent years thinking about it.
Do you like being observed?
No. Why do not? I like being observed?
Yeah, well, you observe other
I
people.
Know.
Do you like being looked at, observed, judged?
It's a good question, eh? No, I don't.
Why not?
Because you become self-aware of everything that you do and the way that you behave. And then it's just like you suddenly become paralysed by who am I? It's all a performance. Life's just a performance. Who am I actually?
Do you think so, though? Because when I do these interviews, I'm really aware of where my pen is, what I'm looking at, even the way I drink. Like,
it's elegant.
And I'm thinking about every single aspect of this interview, even your hairy legs.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they are on. I was like, they're not even on screen, but there you go.
They are there.
Am I hyper-aware of those things, like, normally? No.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah?
But as soon as the camera kind of comes on...
then you're hyper-aware.
Yeah.
Do you love the camera?
It's...
who am I, Kim Hill? Do you love the camera? You've done Kim Hill before.
Well, that's the thing. Do you love the camera or not? I do love the camera.
Yeah, so do I.
But, you know, very rarely do I look at it and go, God, it's really captured me well. Especially daytime, especially outside. What, am I 40 or am I 67?
Well, that's actually a tale of a good actor. If you can look 40 or 60.
Yeah, I'm 67. Unfortunately, you're not 23.
No. Do you think that your career is going the way that you've always wanted it to? And when you dive into TV work, you know, you did that snack masters, things like that, do they pay your bills so that you can do whatever you want?
Yes.
That's what I did too. I did the Masked Singer.
Yes.
Yeah. That paid some bills.
It paid some bills, but I also enjoy it. I like, with Snapmasters, for example, like, it's obviously not in my wheelhouse. It's not like what I'm actually drawn to do. But I did get some kind of teacher's pet thrill out of nailing it or something, and I didn't always nail it. Like, sometimes the walk and talk, which I'm sure you've done.
No, I can't do that.
And you just have to be prepared that the first take never works. And you're like, I'm so sorry. And the first day was horrific of filming that. I just couldn't get the walk. I can't walk and talk at the same time.
How are you going to act then?
I know.
You can't walk and talk. You're doing a hiking movie.
I know.
How did you walk and talk?
Well, that's the thing. My character barely talks.
Give it away. Spoiler alert, everyone.
I've thought all this through. And then also, if it's a scene, it's like, oh, I was wondering if my character could sit in this. Could maybe sit in the scene. Yeah. But there was a question before.
I can't remember. Are you doing it your way? TV work, does it pay the bills?
And one before that? Yeah. Did I? Is this how I foresaw it?
Yeah.
No, like, yes, in the sense, like, I was always kind of drawn to this kind of world. Like, I was obsessed with movies and stuff as growing up. I think there was, as well as doing all the theatre stuff, like, the Video Easy where you could get 6 weeklies for $12 or something.
Five for ten.
God,
I used to stand there needing to poo because I was so excited. You know when you stand there trying to choose a video, yes, but you need to poo because
not really allowed to use their bathroom.
No, you're not. So you just have to hold it in.
I've got distinct memories about using the bathroom at the OEC as well, so obviously really? I feel the same.
So you're obsessed with videos and movies.
Yeah. So that was kind of like, in that sense. But then in terms of what I'm doing now, like, podcasts didn't exist then, and neither did kind of Snapchat or video or social media. So the fact that I'm doing these things is a surprise. Like, if you went to childhood Tom, he'd be like, excuse me, what?
No, he'd be in the bloody farm in the shed.
He'd be like, I'm too busy for this. Yeah. Iodising teats.
I'm too busy, my dad. I've got to get roast beef in the oven.
Yeah.
Yep. Mum's got the washing.
God, I'm too busy trying to get this
jackknife.
Yeah.
Do you enjoy doing TV or theatre?
Theatre.
Aww.
I think, like, theatre's where I'm at. Like, it always just excites me so much. With television, you just have to be vulnerable to... I just always ruin the first takes. Like, I just can't... And I just have to be at peace with that. But I'm just, like, going into it. You're like, right, Tom, okay, we're running out of time. We need this scene now. And you're like, okay, well, just so everyone knows, I'm going to F this up royally.
But is that your shtick? Is that your thing?
That's my shtick, I think. The first take is always a splat, 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 splat. Can we do that again? I'm so sorry.
But sometimes when you're doing a film, you have to do like 20 takes.
Yeah.
And do you do that?
That's preferable.
Wow.
No, I think like 6 is a magic number.
Okay. And I know everyone will be talking to you about this, but I'm a true fan. Mm. Your Facebook parodies of Chris Luxon, Judith Bloody Collins, Paula Bennett, they're magic. You don't get paid for them, eh? You just do them.
I just do them. I think when money kind of gets involved, suddenly you're kind of beholden to something, even if they're like, just do what you want to do. Like,
it's still funny.
There's, you know, Patreon and things like that, but no. I love it. Yeah, I love doing it. So it's a complete, the payment is just doing it.
Are you surprised by its success or grateful for its success?
I'm really grateful for its success. What I came to understand is that satire, especially political satire, is an outlet for people and that they do, it's a
free-for-all, right?
Yeah. And the good thing about doing politicians is if they kick up a fuss, it kind of reflects badly on them. So I've kind of chosen the right genre of people to kind of...
Out of. Are you quite left-wing? Because you mostly do...
Yes.
At national... Like, you haven't done Chloe, Woke Lesbo. You haven't done... you didn't do Kiritapu Allen. You didn't do, you know...
I've done Chloe twice. The problem with Chloe... This is so specific. The problem with Chloe is our faces don't meet. Like, I think she's got quite an angular. I've got quite a round one. and it's so monstrous. And it's the same, actually, you know, that's no an excuse anymore, because I stopped doing Chris Luxon because I'm like, this doesn't work, because you can be bald or have his face, you can't have both. But now all I do is I just put lips, I've got a picture of him, and just put lips on.
Yeah.
So now I can do Chloe. But, yeah, I think that's a really good one. So I just need to put my lips on.
Who's your favourite person to impersonate?
Judith Collins is the one that just slips in. It used to be Simon Bridges. It used to be Simon Bridges because he's the only one that I felt I've got him.
Can you do him now?
So, well, that's the thing, is here I am with Anika Moa and got to hit the traps because I've got to get back to Tauranga. But he doesn't live there anymore.
Yeah, no. Me and my wife, we live in Tauranga. And I was on The Masked Singer too, and Anika Moa could not pick me. Is that good?
That's good.
Thank you.
But he does have a hard G with Tauranga.
Tauranga?
Yeah.
Does he say it like that, Tauranga? He's just wrong, man. Can you do me?
I can't.
Go on.
I wish I could. Go on.
Come on. Do me.
That's me. That's you.
Okay, so can't do things on the spot.
Absolutely cannot do things on the spot. I should prep.
No. Kia ora, iti iwi, ko Anika Moa tōku ingoa.
I'm going to butcher that.
Go on, try it.
I can't.
Kia ora, iti iwi.
Kia ora, iti iwi. But I've got to get the voice as well.
Kia ora.
Are you breathy?
Kia ora, iti iwi. Kia ora, I think I am, yeah. Kia ora te iwi. Kia ora te iwi. Oh, now I'm thinking too much.
And you're also quite... You're...
I'm from Christchurch, so there is a little accent there.
Yeah, but your personality, you've got a strong personality, but your mannerisms are quite neutral.
What are you saying? I'm bland and vanilla?
No, not at all. You've got this beautiful sun... You're a beautiful sunshine.
But you're saying
I'm
that
turning myself
neutral.
Into worse and worse...
I'm crazy. I'm wild. I go to bed at 8 every night, I'm not kidding. Have you had many complaints about being mean about people?
Not so much from the politicians. I've done things where it's definitely been, I've been essentially, like, I did one where I was being a long-haul truck driver and I got a cease and desist letter for it.
What?
I know.
Why?
Because I was saying that this person was just living off no-dose. Remember no-dose pills? Yep. Cease and desist, we want you to take it down. And I thought...
From no dose?
No, not from no dose. No dose fully support
what?
Me.
From
the trucking company. We always, you know, it was very important for us that our truck drivers take care of themselves, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Got one of those. Got some kickback because I did I've got a boomer dad character who got scammed. And quite a few people go, it's not something to take the piss out of.
Oh, yeah. Because the elderly are very vulnerable.
Very susceptible to it.
Yeah. And you got a lot of slack about Jacinda Ardern's cat that died.
Yes,
And it was too soon, wasn't it?
It was too soon.
It was
too soon, but the timing had to be happen. It had to. Something takes over.
Good
All these
you.
Things take over.
Yeah. My favourite one of yours was I think, a throwaway one, but it's the 100-year-old Nan.
Oh, yes.
Who just wants to die.
Yes.
She's like, oh, God, someone. If my husband's meeting me in heaven, he's been gone for so long, I'll turn right back round and go to hell. Oh, God, I laughed and laughed and laughed.
Good. I have had... been in that situation with someone very elderly. She was kind of a family friend kind of stuff, and she's like, she just wanted to go. And she wasn't afraid to say it. Yeah.
I would be like that too. And sadly, on my mum's side, they live forever. And on my dad's side, they all die.
So maybe it'll balance out that you'll have bang on
just in the middle
life expectancy.
85, yes. Then I'm gone. You have these amazing characters that you do. How do you nail... The woman character so well. Like, were you a woman in a past life or?
Yeah, isn't it funny? I don't know. I've just got an affinity with them. I don't know. It's kind of inexplicable. But their experience, I totally get. And it's not like my mum was like a typical, you know, a typical mum, and the kind of the characters I don't do, you know, the loud talking mums. My mum wasn't like that at all. So I don't know where I got it from. So I've got no answer for you, except for there is definitely an affinity there. Women aged, you know, it tends to be in their 50s who like drinking wine and cats.
Fiona.
Yeah, your Fionas of the world. And, yeah, we're kindred spirits. But I've got no answer for you.
Well, that's okay. It just comes out of you. Yeah. And you define what... Because these women that you're portraying, they're all laughing along with you.
Yes.
We're all going through perimenopause and menopause, and we're all like, he's so right, isn't he? What a great guy.
How does he know about... Well, the perimenopausal thing came because I did a show down in Christchurch, and these five women kind of gravitated towards me afterwards, and they're like, you have to do one of it, because they were all perimenopausal at the same time.
They're all sweating.
And they're all sweating and going, I've just been yelling at my husband for the way he was holding his spoon.
Yes.
And I was like, I don't know if it's really my story to talk about being perimenopausal, but I did it anyway, and everyone loved it.
Yeah. Keep doing it, I reckon.
Maybe it's because my sister's a little bit younger than this, but maybe it's the fascination with my... No, but it's not. It's not.
What's
it's not
this
like
thing with your sister.
I know. I just thought she was so glamorous, and it's because she was hugely popular, and I wanted to be popular.
I really wanted to ask you about mental health and anxiety, as well as being a comedian. Have you ever struggled with your mental health or had anxiety?
It's an interesting thing. I've never had anything kind of diagnosed, but sometimes when you look back on behaviours, I've definitely I think I've got maybe situational anxiety rather than inexplicable anxiety. Mm-hmm. So when things are kind of going wrong or things are falling apart, like I don't really cope with it well, and I kind of just resort to kind of going straight to the nearest BP and just grabbing all the chips and just eating them quietly, scurrying away in the bedroom.
Yeah.
But
what's your idea of things going wrong?
Well, in a work type setting, it would be like missing deadlines and stuff, or just kind of like not handling a tricky working relationship very well and things like that. And rather than kind of being mature and kind of handling it, I just kind of close up shop and not deal with it properly.
Yeah, okay.
And so that would be the extent of it, I think, but it's still kind of like...
Is that what people would say about you? Like, oh, yeah, he's, you know, he shuts shop when he feels anxious or
yeah,
triggered.
I think, yes, all my dear friends would say that, definitely.
Do you have tools to work on it, or, like, have you seen a therapist, or...?
Yeah, I did go and see a therapist for a short time, and... they kind of really helped, and then she ended up moving, and I didn't kind of pick it up again. But I'm like, just sitting down with someone, and we did it the way that suited me so well. We had a whiteboard of pros and cons and like ways to kind of work with it and stuff like that. And it's definitely a work in progress, and it's constant. It's just not an easy fix.
I know, it's really not. Do you have anxiety over your movie being out in the world now?
Not so much. I guess what in terms of the movie being out there, it's more kind of a safe, like a pessimism as a safeguard, which I know I kind of need to kind of work on. Like, I kind of like prepare myself to go, you know, it's going to bomb, it's going to get terrible reviews, it's not going to sell and things like that, just as a kind of, which I don't think is necessarily a very healthy way of doing it, but it's obviously, like, if you think of the worst, and then when it's like 75% of that, you feel better than if you have high hopes and your hopes are dashed.
Wow.
Yeah, but no, I can't say I've had a lot of anxiety about it being out in the world. It's also because it's intangible. I think it's more like when you're doing like a live show where you're there and the audiences are there and you're like, will the show go well? That anxiety is a lot more than something. Who knows how people are reacting to it?
Yeah, out of sight, out of mind kind of thing. And you can see people's faces when you're performing to them in real time. So do people expect you to be funny, and is that your kind of your shtick, and do you use it to... perhaps get out of certain situations or to explain yourself? Or
I think it's, people definitely expect me to be funny, especially when I'm kind of touring, doing stand-up around the country. You hang out with people afterwards and they're expecting a good old laugh from you, and it's like it couldn't be further from the truth. Like, I'm quite shy and stuff in big public situations and things, so the comedy doesn't come easily. And then you're like, oh God, I'm disappointing these people, and then you head straight to the BP. I think in terms of getting me out of situation, no, I wouldn't use humour to alleviate the situation. I would tend to more towards the general chit-chat, filling the space with chit-chat. Rather than needing it to be comedic, I'll be like, let's just find some small talk to get us through this.
I generally find I usually use comedy to I don't know, break the ice.
Yes.
But also if I don't want to talk to someone now anymore, I just say, oh, need to do a poo. You just say that. And people can't argue with a poo coming.
No, you can't.
Yeah.
Okay.
See?
Not that
giving
one
you
away.
Ideas. I found this out about you. And I've got I've got four kids and two sperm donors. You have donated two children.
Two children to a lesbian couple, so both of them had a child each, so in the same family. Yes, so they are half siblings.
So how did it come about, and what did it take? How much thought did you put into it?
It's an interesting story because when they kind of reached out to talk to me, I didn't know them, I knew their friend. They were my friend rang up and said, I've got this couple here, would you be just open to meeting them? And I said, sure, because I started doing comedy improv, and that's all about saying yes and to every offer.
Yeah.
So I was like, I'm going to apply this to life and just say yes to everything. And so I went and had coffee with them, and I really liked them, and I've grown to like them even more now. And it began the process, but it was a very long process. First of all, we kind of did it the official way through all the fertility clinic.
Yeah.
So lots of blood tests, and there's no exaggeration here. I'm the most squeamish person I know. And you've asked my friends, like, if they get cut on something, like, I go and lie down on the floor and pass out. So giving blood the first time, I thought I was strong enough to do it on the chair. But they took my blood and I collapsed out of the chair. And the little tiny Filipino nurse, who would have been literally half my weight, had to kind of nurse me down to the ground. And then they were like, then I get a phone call from the fertility clinic going, we forgot to tick syphilis. Can you go back and do another test for syphilis? So there was all that process. But then it was a situation where I did my seven deposits.
Seven?
Because there was two and they wanted to be enough, I guess. Also, it took them a few, like the first, the little girl took three tries to get there.
So that's your five-year-old?
She is now seven
and
he is now five. Yeah.
Okay.
And they're great.
What about the process of being in the room? Like, do they have magazines? Is there a TV? Do you just have to go on your own phone?
How it works, this is the one that we went to. For some reason,
a little bit.
For some reason, the walls, the floors, and the roof ceiling was all carpeted. And like someone explained to me,
that's not good.
I thought it would have been like something you could easily wipe. Like, I think it would be that kind of situation. But someone explained to me it would have been a sound thing because you're in the room. Like, next door's like a consultation room or something like that.
Someone's banging the monkey.
I know. And only one time of the seven did I have to wait. So the room was always free, except for this one time. I'm like, you'll have to wait here. So I had to,
wait
in the
while
corridor
someone's
like this. And then someone came out. Oh, phew. And then you have to walk. You don't leave it there in the room.
You walk with it down.
You walk with it down the hallway. Sorry. And hand it over. There was one well-thumbed Penthouse magazine. Ugh. And that was it.
Oh, they'd have to disinfect that room hard out. So you did all of this so that you could give a couple you hardly knew some beautiful babies.
Yeah.
And what has it taught you about life? Like, are you the gunkle, the uncle, the funkle, the...
Funkle gunkle.
Funkle gunkle.
Yeah.
And they know that you're their donor?
Yeah. So when he was three, we went, he loves the library. So we went into the library and he's like to the librarians, this is my donor. Does he understand it? But they all understand. So I am there. I haven't really sat down and kind of talk to them about what donor actually means, but yeah. For them, I'm Tom the donor.
It's such a beautiful gift to give someone, and I know that because I've had these gifts from my donors. Does it feel weird that you've got children out there in the world that look like you and that will have your genes and hopefully have your acting abilities and you know, comedy sensibilities?
Well, she's definitely because I've got nieces and nephews and stuff, and people are like, you know, kids love to perform and stuff, but I'm like, there are performer kids, and she's definitely a performer kid. And what do I feel about it? I feel increasing, when I kind of first met them, there wasn't like this huge paternal pull or anything. Like, I was expecting to be like, keep away from my baby, I have to protect it at all costs. Like, there's some kind of bond that I hadn't realised was there. But I've got it really good. I like them, which is
fewth.
I'm in their lives, but also I'm not responsible for their child rearing, which is great because, you know, I do like to sleep in.
Yeah.
And but it's also a beautiful experiment. It's not experiment. It's like a I'm watching. I've got an invested interest in some two children to see what they're going to be turning out like and who they are and all that kind of stuff. It's great.
It's like they're not bloody having anxiety things and heading to the thing and eating chips and ice creams.
Oh, God, I know. Please don't do that.
Please don't. Teach them good therapy thing techniques. What about your whānau? Like, are they like, oh, we want to hang out with our moko,
Yeah, they are very... My parents have kind of had a really good kind of attitude to it, like it's on there. If they want to come and hang out, it's there's no pressure.
Aww.
And so they probably see my parents probably every 6 months, I'd say.
That's so lovely.
Yeah.
What a good thing.
Yeah. Aww. It's worked out really well. It's really lovely.
See, lesbians need men. So
I know, but as soon as we can work out how to turn marrow into sperm,
I'll say. Yeah. Yeah, we'll work on that and then you'll all be gone.
Yeah.
And you can write a movie about it, how all the lesbians kill all the men. What's next for you? Do you have, this worldwide stardom? Like, you know, Catherine Tate, you know, all these amazing comics and comedians and actors. Is that your dream?
It really is my dream, but it's a life lesson I've learned. I've been around for a long time. The life lesson I've learned is it all just comes down to you and that laptop every day, just sitting down, the routine of getting the things and building the blocks, because I've been going over to the States back and forth, and if you don't have the goods to give them all the good ideas, then it's kind of fruitless and stuff like that. So it's more about having that as a concept and just focusing on the day.
But would that be a dream for you to be able to go over and make movies and write movies and act with Tina Fey and...
It really would, but it's...
Robert De Niro. Imagine that. Imagine
working with Robert De Niro. Like, imagine that. Yes, it definitely is. Yeah. But it's also like, it's not just Hollywood in the States. Like, what would be ideal for me, because I do love travelling so much, is, you know, you get one job in Tunisia and you do a film in Tunisia and then you have another one in the UK. So you do something in the UK. Like, that would be amazing.
You're not asking for much, are you?
No, I'm not.
Does that mean that you're a romantic...
Carbon footprint is...
Yeah. Radiohead would hate you.
Yeah.
Does that mean that you're a romantic? Because you like the idea of going to places and sashaying in and swaying, sashaying away. And
yeah, of course. Yeah, 100%. And going in and having an amazing, and like, you know, having maybe not so much romantic relationships, but really having intense relationships, you know, meeting a Tunisian person. You're like, God, this is, I'm vibing here. Yeah. Let's get the instruments out. Let's make a song.
Yeah. Get That's some tiles me. And some, yeah.
That's me to a T. If I could do that, yes. Oh, the practicalities of life is not for me.
I would love...
I haven't replied to my accountant in 6 weeks.
I don't like accountants. I that's my dream too, is to just be... I don't know, like, it doesn't even need to be music. It could just be a feature film. It could just be something with some of my favourite actors and getting to go to Greece and Italy and, oh, Lord forbid, India. You know what I mean? Just places that are... special.
And those, all countries are good, but those three.
Thank you.
Good choices. Mm-hmm.
But I will go vegetarian in India because I don't want to get...
Deli belly.
Yeah. Do you believe in love at first sight?
Yeah. And to elaborate on that, it's not always romantic, but like sometimes you just like, who is that energy? I need to be near that.
Mm.
I definitely do, or at least like love within the first hour. I think that I've done an experiment where I was kind of like seeing the beginning stages of, like, there was someone that was so good on paper, and then there was someone who was like not necessarily so good on paper, but there was some chemistry kind of love at first sight kind of vibe.
Is this
and they
for you?
Won. This was for me.
Yeah, the one on the not so good on paper one.
Yeah.
So are they your partner now?
Yeah.
And was that
love? Not so good on paper because he is 10, he's 10 years younger than me.
What? Catch. Good on you.
He was 10 years younger. He was still at kind of a university. So I was like, what am I doing?
Oh, my gosh. Do you go, oh, do you remember when Friends came out? And he's like, what? Who? What's Friends? What's?
Yeah.
Who's Michelle Pfeiffer?
Yeah.
Drew Barrymore?
Yeah.
Pokemon.
So you won't get this reference because...
Like, what are you talking about?
He's like, I remember Pokemon. I was 6. Sorry, I beg your pardon. When you just think, okay, when I was 25, he wasn't, you know, legal.
Oh, okay. Do you believe in soulmates?
No, that's an interesting term. Like, I would use the word kindred spirit.
Well, it's the same diff. Gosh,
I know. I feel like soulmates is like bigger and, you know, the top. I think kindred spirits is like more of a, like, you can have multiple kindred spirits of people that you just kind of like, I get you, we're on to it.
Okay.
And I do believe in that. And like, it's crazy that you can meet people that are so similar, even though, you know, completely different countries and things like that. But you're like, my God, what is it about our personalities that just so in sync? And then you're completely polar opposite to your brother.
I love your mind because I can see it working. It's working all the time.
Yeah.
And if you do write a movie about me, can I star in it?
100%. I would love you to be in it.
Yes!
And guess what? You can be in the next one, whatever that becomes.
Okay. Yeah. I'll do the walking and talking. You can sit.
Yeah.